All right, owner, operator, CEO, man extraordinaire, owner of Vibeco over there in Wyoming, Rhode Island, Carl Waddinson, who Ed Fitzpatrick said in the Sunday Journal might be considering a run for governor. Carl Waddinson in studio with us. Carl, good morning. Nice
good morning,
to see you.
Helen. How are you?
I'm very impressed with your operation over there in Vibeco. I got the grand tour the other day, and even though you and I have met before, it was exciting to come in and see this business that's thriving in the state of Rhode Island with American-made products and meeting your workers, because my takeaway from all of this was it was great to see workers happy to be at work, enthused about what they're doing, and to meet a guy like you who frequents the factory floor and goes to what other people might consider the lowest worker in the shop and daily asking him, how's it going?
Yeah. And, you know, this is one of the keys to what we're doing here in our state, that possibilities to get close to people, get close to the process, go to where the work is being done. And that's been my focus all along, is trying to get CEO presidents to go to where the work's done, get leaders in the public sector, go to where the work's done, because our job is not management. Everybody talks about management, and we go to school for management. It's leadership. And when you lead, Helen, you were in the armed forces.
Well,
right?
I worked with the Navy.
Worked with the Navy.
Yes,
but
Department of Defense.
Did managing or leading work best?
Oh, well, we always, that's a saying. You lead by example.
You
find out what your people are doing. You promote within. You consult the guy, the lowest guy on the ladder. And that's how you get that. That's how the ship rolls in the Navy.
Right. And it's so profound that when you authentically, you can't just go out and pseudo do it, because people know when you're pulling the wool over their eyes and just going out to do
it. Lip service.
Yeah. And I call it glad handing. Go out and glad hand. I mean, you got to get down to the nitty gritty. And you have to celebrate, too, because the people that work for me are some of the brightest people that I've ever known. They amaze even the thoughts that I could even have of doing excellence. They surpass that. It's unbelievable. The things that they dream up are fantastic. But that keeps us competitive here, Helen.
Well, that's what it's all about.
Keeps us competitive.
I don't know if you saw Steve Frias' article in the Cranston Herald the other day, but it's a great article. We posted it up on the website. In Decline and In Denial, and talking about, until we can make this state more business friendly, and until we can get our policymakers, lawmakers, politicians in the state to understand that we need to do something and we need to do it fast, we're going to be in decline. And his theory here, and he's got a lot to back it up, is that we've basically been in decline since about 100 years, certainly since 1938.
Yeah, well, think about it. Everything has a life cycle. People have a life cycle. Organizations, private organizations, and states and cities and public communities have a life cycle. So what I mean by that life cycle is it's a time now to take a look at, with inside our four walls, how do we shore up the processes and the things to make sure that people can succeed. I was listening on the way in and I heard Sue.
Yes.
Talking about a business here in Rhode Island. She employs some people. It's not a big, huge thing, but she employs people.
Right.
And small wins are what I'm all about. Small wins all
Back
day long.
The state. Yep.
All day long.
Small business.
We're not a big state. We can't afford big wins. So we take the small wins. So what Sue really needs is to have a clear and predictable process that she can apply for minority status. And if she doesn't fall under the auspice of minority status, someone needs to tell her that this is what it looks like. You have to meet these benchmarks. So, it befuddles me that she's having some confusion and having some trouble do this. Maybe she doesn't, and then she has to be the big business person to say, well, I don't fall into this category, but maybe she does, but she has the sense, the feeling that no one's out there to help her. No one cares. So why should I care about my state? Right? That's the sentiment I got. Did you feel the same thing?
Absolutely. Yeah, we were talking earlier in the week and last week, too, because it's been out there now since the end of December about the latest census and how we're bleeding people in this state. 25,000 people since 2004 that have decided, I can't do it. And they don't, you know, they try. Some of them do try and make these statements, but a lot of them just give up and they move. And they don't move that far away. I mean, some do, but some just go right next door to Massachusetts.
Well, remember, you say we're losing people. Are we really losing people, or are we losing residencies of people?
True. Yes.
Yeah, I'm seeing house building going on all over the place.
Yeah. We've got listeners that have moved just across the border, live now in Massachusetts, but still work in Rhode Island. Yeah.
And it's sad to say that. But the bigger thing that really concerns me are the young people here in the state. And we have, you know, such a big population of students here in the city for a small state. I think per capita, I don't know the facts, maybe you do, but per capita, we have to be like a Boston, because Boston's known as the biggest student population in the country.
Right, and there, I've often said there's got to be some sort of, if we want to look at incentives, because government doesn't create jobs. They don't. They get in the way.
Well, what they do is they could create
an incentive for those college students to stay, though.
Or create a platform. Let me tell you a story about EDC.
Tell me right after this. All right, 8:20, we're going to take a quick break here on the Helen Glover Show. WHAJ, I'm Helen Glover, along with Carl Waddenston. He owns Vibeco over there. Is it Richmond or Wyoming, technically?
We're in Wyoming, but yeah.
Okay. All right. Yeah. I toured the factory the other day, and I tell you, this guy, you're like the flu, Carl. You're infectious, but in a good way, because I could see that your workers were enthusiastic, and that comes from the top. And we were talking during the break here. Leadership comes from the top down, and you inspire your people, and they're willing to work harder and work longer. If they see buy-in themselves, I mean, they're not a slave ship. I mean, they're not going to do this if there's no buy-in. But you're one of those hands-on guys. I know you wanted to tell me this EDC story, but let me just ask you. We're told always that manufacturing is dead in Rhode Island. In fact, it's dead in this country because we're being put out of work by people that'll do things cheaper in other countries.
No.
You're a manufacturer.
Manufacturing touches so many different places. And yesterday we were at New England Tech with a group of people from Smithfield, from Lincoln, from Southern Rhode Island. We're all looking for people. We're hiring. We're robust. We're getting business done. We're innovating. We're creating. We're keeping up with technology. And we're not afraid.
You're hiring. We got 67,000 people or whatever out of work.
The group of people that I was with yesterday, there were five of us. And I bet you in those five, we could have hired 25 people like this.
Why didn't you?
Well, we're looking for values and characteristics. And we're looking for some support from the educational component of the state to get them some basic skills and this community. And we're not looking for the quintessential, you know, perfect person. We know we can't plug and play. And the thing that manufacturing's done in this new renaissance of inshoring, doing things in the U.S., is we know we have to put skin in the game. We know we have to train, but get me the right DNA, the right characteristics, and we've been trying to work with Charlie Fogarty, who's up on this, but we got to get those with DLT. We got to get the wheels going. Show us a little bit more. Look inside of Helen, who Helen Glover is. Show us some characteristics and values. Then we'll hire her. We'll put some money in. You guys help us with a little bit of matching funds, and we'll have a super workforce here.
Now, it's been suggested by Ed Fitzpatrick that you may be interested in running for governor. I know.
Helen, it's early
too
on. It's early on.
You're a businessman with no political background. How do you expect to do this?
The same way that I did my lean journey. What did I know about lean? What did I know about
How you run your company.
This is how, this is the operational system that we use. What did I know about that? I know a lot about people. I know a lot about processes, and I know that people are stuck in bad processes, so I'm an operational guy. I'm a human psychology kind of guy to get people with a sense of purpose, a sense of belonging, and a sense of that I care about them. And I'm here really to break down roadblocks for you. That's my main job all day long is break
down
roadblocks.
Be all you can be type thing.
Be all you can be.
But personal responsibility and accountability.
Accountability is key. And also,
can you work with the unions?
Yeah, I think so. George Neese sits on the board at EDC with me. We trade dialogue all the time. And I think George is an extremely smart guy. And he knows that the future is changing for unions. It doesn't mean you need to deconstruct any unions, but they need to be a willing partner as well. And you asked me, you said, what about the big blockheads in the unions? The guys that, you know, just...
The thugs. Yeah.
Well,
the line. I know you don't want to use that. I'll do it. Yeah, the guy that's going to tell you, nope, sorry, that's not the way we do it.
Yeah, the guy that's been driving a Ford and he'll always drive a Ford.
Sure.
Right?
Yeah.
Those will be the biggest cheerleaders for this operational system. They will be the biggest cheerleaders. I tell you.
I'm not being skeptical or disrespectful. You've got as I said, you're infectious. You've got great ambition, and I would not do anything to dampen that. But I just.
But I've seen it in practice in upstate New York.
Yes. Okay. Well, I'm watching the clock, Carl. Time flies when I'm with you. 8:30. We're going to take a quick break here. Carl Waddenston has got that EDC story for us. Also, an interesting one. He was telling us upstate New York, their equivalent to RIPTA, and how they went in and it was again bleeding money. Sounds just like RIPTA, and they were able to turn it around and make it profitable. Interesting. 8:30. Quick break for the latest. Ed Fitzpatrick outed him in his column on Sunday's Journal. Carl Waddenston, who's the owner of Vibeco over there in Wyoming, Rhode Island. It's a factory business. It's made in America stuff. And Carl, you were telling me you didn't even lose anybody in the recession. You kept everybody on. They worked overtime.
We were trying to hire people.
So what's your secret to success? And I'm not going to bother to ask you about governor because
The secret to success, just like the secret to success here in the state or any venture that you do, listen to the customer. We listen to our customers. They want it faster, quicker, cheaper. So what do we have to do?
And you were able to deliver.
Faster, quicker, cheaper. Deliver. The name of the game is speed here in the U.S. The faster we can do things... the better for everybody.
I thought the name of the game in Rhode Island was I know somebody who knows somebody. I got a job and I don't really have to do anything. And you can't get rid of me because I'm a union person.
Nah, you know that mantra is dying pretty quick. That mantra
is it, or are the people that don't fit that bill move out of the state because they get frustrated?
Well, of course they do. Of course they do. But you need to get a change agent that's going to say, you know what, guys, that's great.
Are you that change agent?
Could be.
You could be.
Could be.
Okay.
Or, you know, in
the
article.
Do you want to be?
No, in the article, remember, Helen, in the article I said, If somebody steps up and lets me do the things that I'm good at, I'm willing to follow. And I'm following now doing my EDC stuff, and we'll get back to that story.
So you'll be a soldier or a general, but.
I'll be a soldier or a general. I'm happy to do it. You know, in the armed forces, if somebody is better equipped to be the leader, and no one's chimed in, even our current governor, Governor Chafee, no one's chimed in. A good soldier is willing to step back and support the guy that might have, or the gal that might have a little bit more, right?
I often think leadership is born in someone. I don't know that you can make somebody a leader that's not a leader. I think those are inherent traits. But
I'm a leader, that's for sure.
You're a born leader, yeah. And people, you inspire people, and it's obvious in your employees. All right, tell me about the equivalent of our RIPTA.
Okay, so this is RIPTA.
In upstate New York.
And I've given George Nee the book. I've given the governor the book. I've given a bunch of people up at the Smith Street the book.
And is it used as a doorstop, or are they reading
it? No, I hope they're reading it.
Okay.
So this is a call out to George. I'm going to put George on the spot now. So Mark Aish, guy takes over Rochester Genese Public Transportation. Heavily, heavily funded by the state. They're always in the hole. It was like a slot machine when you get onto the bus. You didn't know how much you were going to pay because they're always raising rates. They thought it was a revenue problem rather than an internal problem.
Oh, yes.
This guy, Mark Aish, a friend, takes over this and brings all the union guys, heavily unionized. It's upstate New York. You know, they've always been, they've been on the winning train, so they can do what they want.
Sure, sounds like RIPTA. Okay.
Yeah, they can do what they want.
Give us more money.
He takes this over, pulls everybody into the meeting, and they probably had three or four directors like RIPTA. Mm-hmm. Three or four directors.
And top heavy.
And the people know, we're going to outlouse this guy.
Yeah.
He can say whatever he wants. It's just another meeting.
Yep.
So he looks at everybody, and the first day, he was on a radio thing that I did a while, and I'm doing internet stuff. So he told everybody, we no longer have passengers. And they're all scratching their heads. What do you mean we don't have passengers? You have customers. You have customers. What do you mean, customers? And you have stores on wheels. Is your store going to be a store that's on time? Is your store always going to be clean? Is your store going to be friendly? How are you going to treat your customers? And these guys, you can imagine.
Not pride, not competition.
Yeah, so you know, okay. You can imagine the grumbling in the ranks.
Right.
And their arms folded and their biceps, they're pumping up their bicep with their fist and saying, ah, you're not going to do this. And he worked and worked and worked that first year, right? And they started changing. They were $20 million in the hole. $20 million in the hole. 3-year period of time, $10 million surplus. They went from worst to first. And those same guys, the blockheads, because you said, how are you going to get these guys that are so well entrenched, so entitled?
Yeah,
so
how are you going to turn it around when they can just look at
those
you and go,
guys,
my union contract says screw you, Carl.
Those guys, and this is my glimmer of hope. You know, this is my thing. I'm the guy, the optimist, that just sees a little bit of light and shoots for that light.
Yeah, okay.
Those guys came up and hugged him at the end of the first year and said, oh, my God. This is 6'4", 6'6", big, brawly guys, and just said, I've never had so much fun in my life. Where were you 27 years ago?
So it can be done.
It can be done. And they have the highest rate. They have the highest rate of ride per capita in the world. They've stabilized their cost. They've given everybody a sense of purpose.
So they went from $20 million in the hole in 3 years
to
$10 million.
And he wrote a book about this. He's no longer the head of that transportation, but he's going around helping others in other places.
Has
and
he been
shown
here?
Him the recipe.
Has he been here?
No, he hasn't been here yet. I've invited him, but I need the permission.
Yeah.
So this is my point about leading. Yes, I am a born leader.
Lead, follower, get out of the way.
This is my point about leading. Yes, I'm a leader, but my leadership would be connecting our state to all these things if someone steps up. You see where I'm going with
worst
this?
Worst to first.
Worst to first.
All right, the EDC story.
EDC story. Real quick story.
Yep.
Here's a young kid that goes to Brown. Gets three friends together, not even from Rhode Island. He's from, I think, Atlanta.
Mm-hmm.
Max Winograd, company called New Label. He's figured out how to do these adhesive labels like on the pill bottles and UPS labels instead of having a peeling back because that's an extra step and 50% is carbon footprint waste and 50% is usable. Him and his buddies at Brown figure out a way to do this to have repeatable labels without that backing. Sounds kind of simple, but he's figured this out, patented. He has a new way to do this. Comes to EDC and he says, I need $1,250,000. We listen to this whole thing, and I'm drilling Max on, you know, who you talk to, what's going on, and I see the purpose of this, that we reduce landfill, all the great stuff. We reduce steps, the cost to CVS, how many millions of labels, trillions of labels do they peel off where they could give the prescription an extra millisecond quicker to the customer and reduce the garbage, right? He takes the $1,250,000. He's looking for other funding. And as of the end of last year, he hasn't even drawn down on the money yet because other people have stepped up to help him. What a win story. He just needed the EDC to back him to show that someone, more people are behind him going into the second round of financing. How cool is that? He will be the next G-Tech when this thing takes off.
Hey, let me ask you just a quick question here on 38 Studios since we're talking about this guy hasn't drawn down the funding. We're hearing that the state of Rhode Island's out $100 million. How much did 38 Studios draw down on the money that was given them?
Well, a lot of that stuff. Now, since in litigation, I don't want to get into too many things.
Because I've heard they only got $49 million of that $100 million.
$49 million.
So why are we using $100 million as the...
Because you have debt services and you have a whole bunch of other things to bond people. It gets so financial. These are the financial architects of the world, right?
Mm.
It gets complex.
Carl Watterson, you're a very inspirational...